What if I told you that there was a solution to climate change? One that almost everyone can help with, and which is safe, affordable, and that we can begin doing right now. That solution is trees. Ha ha ha, Yishan, I've heard that one before. Yes, planting trees is good. That's not really going to solve climate change, is it? Yes, it is. We all know that eliminating our fossil fuel emissions is something we need to do. We're all working on that one, but reducing emissions alone won't solve the problem. What do we need to do to close the gap? To answer that question, let's take a closer look at what climate change really is. Climate change is happening because there's too much carbon dioxide, too much CO2 in the atmosphere. That's it. It's not because of pollution, it's not because of ozone, it's not because of plastic in the oceans. Those are all problems too, but the reason climate change is happening is because there's too much CO2 in the air. So the answer is, what is the fastest and cheapest way to get CO2 out of the air? And the answer to that is trees. More accurately, it's forests. And if you want to get technical, it's the restoration of biodiverse native forests, which really just means planting a lot of native species of trees, because those trees anchor the natural regeneration of forests. We can just say trees. But is it enough? How can trees be enough? Well, let's think about carbon. At the highest level, the Earth has three great pools of carbon. There's carbon in the ocean, there's carbon in the land, and there's carbon in the air. The problem is that those pools are out of balance. We took too much carbon out of the ground, and we put it into the air. So we need to pull it out of the air, and we need to do it in the fastest way possible. The math works a little bit like this. Since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in 1750, we've put about 2 trillion tons of CO2 into the atmosphere. Now, the Earth has been trying to help us out a lot. Each year, it absorbs about half the CO2 we emit, so right now, there's only about 1 trillion tons of CO2 hanging around out there. How's the Earth absorbing all that? Well, it's mostly the ocean and all the existing trees and plants doing it. More on that later. What we've got is 1 trillion tons of CO2 in the air, warming the planet right now, and we're putting out more every year, about 45 billion tons each year. Now, it's a big job to stop emitting, but even if we waved a magic wand and turned off our civilization today and went to zero emissions, we'd still have that 1 trillion tons of CO2 hanging around, warming the planet for at least another 50 to 100 years. And without any of our tools and civilization, we'd be screwed. The weather would continue to get worse, and we wouldn't have anything we could do about it. So we have to remove that CO2. It turns out that 1 trillion trees will do that job. It turns out that 1 trillion trees will do the job. One mature tree will sequester, roughly speaking, between 1 and 20 tons of CO2. Let's take the most conservative end of that, 1 ton, and you can see that 1 trillion trees will take up 1 trillion tons of CO2. 1 trillion trees at a density of about 300 trees per acre will require 3 billion acres of land. I'll get to how we find that in a moment, but I want to point out something important. Most people think trees grow out of the ground. They don't. They grow out of the air. Trees grow out of the air. They are made primarily out of carbon extracted from the CO2 in the air and out of water that falls as rain from the air. If you have a tree, it can't help but pull CO2 out of the air. There's nowhere else for it to get it. This is what makes trees so superior as a solution. From the moment a tree begins to grow, from the moment it's just a tiny sapling, it is actively removing CO2 from the air. This is an obvious fact that's been in front of all our faces, and we've forgotten it. Okay, so the question your smart friend is going to say is there enough land to plant enough trees? Do we have 3 billion acres we can restore into forest? Well, 5 years ago, the answer would have been no. Back then, if you were to count up all the land that got enough natural rainfall, there would only be about 1, maybe 2 billion acres available. But is there some way to get more land? It turns out there is. The world has 4.7 billion acres of land that is currently considered degraded, desertified, or otherwise unusable. It's generally considered the least desirable land in the world. Nothing much grows there. It's mostly desert. But most of what we consider desert today was not always desert, especially not in ancient times. And long timescales are what matters when it comes to species and ecosystems. Did you know that before modern human history, much of Australia was a rainforest? Or that the Sahara Desert also used to be a forest? Most of the regions we consider desert today are deserts because ancient prehistoric human activity reduced them to desert through the use of fire and grazing animals. We've been changing the environment for far longer than most people know. So the question becomes, can we convert deserts into forests? It turns out the answer is yes. Over the past few decades, there have been multiple successful projects in countries such as Jordan, Spain, China, and the country of Israel is pretty much the story of making the desert bloom. In all cases, the limiting factor is freshwater availability. Now, for 3 billion acres, we can't use existing supplies of freshwater. Planting a ton of forests can deplete local groundwater supplies, and there's already a global freshwater scarcity problem. How do we solve that? The only other source of freshwater is to use desalination to extract freshwater from the ocean. Until recently, desalination was only economically viable by using cheap fossil fuels. Desalination takes a lot of energy. And if you're burning fossil fuels making water to irrigate your forests, that doesn't make sense. But recently, a great shift happened. Starting a few years ago, solar energy became cheaper than the cost of fossil fuels. This means, for the first time in history, we can power desalination using clean, renewable energy, and we can produce arbitrarily large amounts of fresh water for the world. As a minor side effect, the freshwater scarcity problem is over. As soon as the whole world realizes that solar desalination is possible, that problem is solved. But for our purposes, we can now produce all the water we need to irrigate up to 3 billion acres of dry, degraded, or desertified land to restore a trillion trees worth of new forest, enough to offset all or most of human emissions. The trillion trees, just by growing up, can't help but absorb the trillion extra tons of CO2 I told you about that's hanging around in our atmosphere. That's how we pull that carbon in the air back down to the ground. And we can do this, starting today, using technology that already exists. And it can be undertaken in parallel by organizations and countries all over the world at massive scale. While it is not the only solution to climate that we should pursue, it is the simplest, fastest, and most immediately scalable one, and it is probably the best tool we have to close the gap on our climate change problem. In fact, many organizations all over the world have begun to realize this and are planting millions of trees each year. On the Big Island of Hawaii, we have numerous forest restoration projects, and we've most recently demonstrated that it is possible to restore forest even in the driest regions. The island itself contains 8 of the world's 13 different climate zones. This makes it a microcosm for the planet. Restoration projects on Big Island have included tropical, temperate, and dry forests, and now it's been done even in the most arid desert region. Do you remember what I said earlier about deserts not always being deserts? On the Big Island, the deserts in the northwestern corner, an area known as Kohala, were not always deserts. 200 years ago, the entire region was sandalwood forest, from the mountains down to the shore. They were cut down, the entire region was deforested to feed the lucrative sandalwood trade, and the land never recovered. In time, without the forest to cool the air and attract moisture, it became a desert. But that's a process that can work in reverse. We have found that with sustained effort and careful selection of native species, forests which have been lost for centuries can be restored, with benefits to biodiversity, water management, and local communities. What is the lesson here that this island can teach the rest of the world? On an island, your environmental issues are magnified. They're made much clearer, more stark. Your resources are limited, and it's hard to bring in more. Your trash doesn't go anywhere. It stays with you. You have to figure out what to do with it. You learn that everyone has to work together, and even though we are all different, we also have many common interests. You learn that unless your plans are in harmony with the natural world, they won't last very long. And you also learn that the Earth is trying to help you. It will provide you with food and water and air, as long as you take care of it. Do you remember what I said at the beginning about how we've released around 2 trillion tons of CO2 into the air, and yet the Earth has already helped us out by absorbing half of that, a trillion tons? The other half, the trillion tons still remaining, That's up to us. We are in a partnership with the Earth. The Earth gave us life. This planet is a biosphere made to help us thrive. It is a spaceship in which we were evolved to live. A friend of mine once said to me, "Solving climate change is not about proposing a return to caveman times. It's about all of us acting like astronauts on spaceship Earth and being smart about managing our resources at a self-contained planetary level." If we can crack this problem, this crisis may be the biggest opportunity for mankind to open a new chapter in our history. Mahalo for coming to my TED Talk.